Hello, my name is Pedro Moura. I'm a part of Foramen Dental Education Surgery Team, and today I will be talking about multiple recession coverage. Many of the patients that visit our clinic exhibit gingival recessions. Sometimes these recessions are circumscribed to individual teeth, and other times the adjacent teeth are also involved. When multiple teeth are involved, in patients with high aesthetic demands, a coronally advanced envelope flap can be a very interesting surgical technique choice, since it allows for recession coverage of multiple teeth in the single procedure without the need for releasing incisions. This procedure usually provides good integration of the tissues regarding color and thickness. It's a technique that we have been utilizing with very good results regarding effectiveness in complete root coverage. Also, minor discomfort after surgery is usually reported by patients. This technique has, of course, been published by Zucchelli and DeSantis in 2000, and the first paper was published regarding treatment of recessions that affected an entire quadrant. This has become known as the lateral approach. And another paper was later published regarding treatment of only the lateral and central incisors, and this has become known as the frontal approach. We select the appropriate technique for each case based on the existence of a recession on the canine. When using the coronally advanced envelope flap, what we do is create surgical papilla through the use of oblique permarginal incisions. These surgical papillae are subsequently mobilized and sutured coronally. The first step to this technique is to determine the oblique incision's position. To obtain this information, what we need to do is measure the depth of recession on the first tooth to be treated in the lateral approach, in this case, the canine. Once we record this value, we can then transpose this value to this tooth's papilla's margin, measuring upward from the tip of the anatomical papilla, adding 1 millimeter. What we achieve now is the endpoint of the oblique incisions. The oblique incision is made starting from the apical margin of the adjacent teeth and ends in the previously determined endpoint. Once we complete this step, we have created, apically to the incision, a couple of surgical papillae. The remaining papillary tissue coronally to the incision is now called an anatomical papilla. We then proceed to the lateral incisor and transpose the recession value to its mesial papilla margin, which will serve as the endpoint of an incision that will start at the apical margin of tooth number 11. So now we repeat this procedure for the first premolar, this time transposing the recession depth values only to the papilla margin distal to the respective tooth. The second premolar is, however, subject of discussion, since no recession can be seen on this tooth. So Zucchelli has described what he calls a false recession technique that will allow us to overcome this problem. This consists of a paramarginal incision mimicking a recession defect. This false recession will now be treated as a real recession, and it will be connected to the margin of the molar and premolar. When designing this recession, one should pay close attention to the shape of the surgical papilla that we are creating, making sure that it will be adequate for the recession coverage once mobilized. The recession coverage is obtained by mobilizing the flap and suturing the surgical papilla coronally to the anatomical papillae. The papilla created mesially will rotate mesially, and the papilla created distally will be rotated distally and mobilized coronally through the canine axis of rotation. In the case that I will show you next, we use two lateral approaches in order to achieve root coverage from tooth 16 to 26. We actually started on the patient's right side and then decided to carry on to the left side when we reached completion of the first quadrant. This patient, a female in her 40s, was looking for a solution to the recession on her maxilla. As we can see, the recession spanned from tooth number 16 to tooth number 26, with the exception of tooth number 15. We can see that keratinitis of tissue availability is not a problem in this case, and this is a major limitation for this technique. We scheduled the patient for a prophylactic and restorative appointment. An implant has been placed on tooth number 15. The patient has for now declined a crown replacement on this implant, which would certainly grant us a better aesthetic result on this tooth. So, an important aspect of this surgery is the variable thickness of the flap. The surgical papillae are created by split thickness. As we can see here, this blade position allows for the splitting of the flap, and we keep going like this until we reach the probable margin of the adjacent teeth. So now we start to reflect the tissue using a small instrument, and this time we will go full thickness, making sure that we expose roughly 3 mm of bone apical to the bony dehiscence. The idea here is to keep an adequate tissue volume and also to allow for a portion of periosteum to cover the root. Now that we have reflected the tissue for about 3 mm, it is time to continue the soft tissue dissection once again in a split thickness fashion, cutting the periosteal muscle insertion. Zucchelli has described this as a deep incision followed by a superficial incision that removes the superficial muscle's insertions remaining on the flap. The combination of these two incisions will allow for a complete and effective mobilization of the flap. We know that the mobilization is complete when the flap can be placed tension-free about 1 mm coronally to the teeth's CEJ, and the surgical papilla tips can be effortlessly sutured to the anatomical papilla bed. You can see me now scaling the root surfaces. We use mini 5 carets and attempt to keep the scaling limited to the area of the root that has been previously exposed. We don't want any damage to the precious connective tissue fibers that insert to the root cementum. The next step consists of deepithelizing the anatomical papillae. In order to complete this task, I like to use a micro scissor or the tip of a blade. Some other clinicians might prefer to use a micro blade. The important aspect is to be sure that there are no remnants of the epithelium on the papillae, as they will serve as a vascular source for the surgical papilla that we created. The use of EDTA for a period of 2 minutes will allow for the smear layer removal and hopefully improve the fibrin clot adhesion. We are now ready to suture. The first area to be sutured is the most distal. The needle will enter from vestibular on the distal papilla, passing through both the anatomical and surgical papillae, connecting them, then exits on the palatal side, is transported medially to the mesial papilla, and is transported from palatal to vestibular through the interdental space, using the back of the needle for this task. The needle will then re-enter vestibularly, this time on the mesial papilla, and similarly will exit palatally. We will then transport it distally and once again make the needle pass to the vestibular side using the back of the needle and then tying the knot where we started. The next area to be sutured is the mesial area, and we will be changing between distal and mesial areas until the final sutures on the central area, which is the area that undergoes the greater advancement. We can see that this suturing technique allows for an interesting adaptation of the marginal tissue to the root recession, allowing for clot stabilization. Here you can see the results immediately post-op. And here it is, side by side with the initial peaks after 1.5 months. I hope you have enjoyed this. For more videos, please visit us at Foramen Dental Education.